Good evening, everybody. Today my topic is laxative. I'll just give a few points about constipation first, and then I will go on to laxative. By definition, the American College of Gastroenterology, chronic constipation means unsatisfactory defecation characterized by infrequent stool passage, difficult stool passage, or both. The presence should be there for more than 3 months to say it's a chronic constipation. It includes straining at stools, sense of difficulty in passing stools, ineffective evacuation, hard and lumpy stools, and prolonged time to stool evacuation, and sometimes even the need for manoeuvres, like use of the fingers. We have the Rome criteria. Every 7 years they make Rome 4th criteria for functional constipation is it must include two or more of the following criteria, like straining during more than 1/4, that is 25% of defecations, lumpy or hard stools, bristles. I'll come to that later, more than 1/4 certification, and the sensation of incomplete evacuation more than 25% of defecations, or a sensation of anorectal blockade more than 25% of defecations, use of manual maneuvers like use of digital evacuation more than 25%, and we have the loose stools are rarely present without the use of laxatives, and there is insufficient criteria for IBS also. So the risk factors would be women greater than men, great advancing age, non-white ethnicity, lower socioeconomic status, pregnancy, etc. The major subtypes of constipation are primary and secondary. The primary includes normal transit constipation, slow transit constipation, or local defecatory disorders. So there are an umpteen number of causes. For example, mechanical obstruction, all these can be corrected by surgeries. Medications, again, even the common drugs like calcium channel blockers, calcium, etc., diuretics, even long, paracetamol can cause constipation. You stop the offending drugs. And these things, endocrine and metabolism, you correct the primary cause. And this neurological disorders, along with rehabilitation therapy, we can give drugs for constipation. So this is a Bristol stool chart commonly used nowadays. So here the grade 4 is normal. Above that is constipation and below that is diarrhea. Okay, 4 is normal, Bristol stool chart. A normal transit constipation, it's very common. The patient finds difficult in passing stools. And usually they have some functional disorder also. They overlap with IBS. Slow transit constipation, again, is common in young females. The bowel movements will be frequently less than 2 per week only. And there will be abdominal bloating also. And defecatory disorders, this is more related to the pelvic floor, and manual evaluation is always seen in this type of patient. And sometimes even laxatives will be ineffective in this patient. So this slide is important. This is a normal resting space. This is a pubic symphysis, and this is a coccyx. The muscles involved now, this one is very important. The puborectalis sling. Normally it's kept tight actually. And here the external anal sphincter. These two are really important. So what happens in a normal defecation? This muscle, puborectalis sling, relaxes. So this so-called recto-anal angle, it should increase by more than 15%, and the external anal sphincter should relax. So when you strain, both the puborectalis muscle as well as your external anal sphincter relax, so the stool is passed easily. If there is any problem here, it will lead to constipation. So this slide is very important. So clinical assessment, again, history is very important. And what are the main warning symptoms is whenever there is weight loss or a bleeding PR or change in the stool caliber which can occur in malignancy or in an elderly late onset, etc. These are so-called the red flag signs. So physical examination, again, hypothyroid always very, very important. Look for pallor in case of anemia. And again, major CNS lesions should be ruled out. So perirectal examination, again, look for local causes always. In any case of constipation, they'll be having some local causes like local problems like fistula, fissure, hemorrhoids, etc. Always do a digital rectal examination. Look for fecal infections, strictures, mass, etc. And again, before doing a rectal examination, always inspect first and then go for the digital rectal examination. During inspection, always look for the, some people look for the local anal reflex also. And again, sorry. Just previous slide. So first you do, you inspect, and the patient, ask the patient to strain actually. The patient strains, the anal waist should descend in between 1 and 4. Less than 1 is not abnormal, greater than 4 is also abnormal. So descent should be either in between 1 and 4 actually. So in palpation, again, do your proper digital rectal examination, look for any mass. And again, ask the patient to strain and the space of your finger, where you can pick up a lot of findings. Diagnosis test again, hemoglobin, ESR, thyroid function is very important, as well as serum calcium is very important. And test for structural diseases, we have, now we have lots and lots of investigations like CT, MRI, NMR, etc. I'll come to that later. For normal colonic transit time, you use radiopaque markers, capsule endoscopy is there, scintigraphy is there, and we have for physiology of defecation, you have various tests like defecography, balloon expulsion test, anal manometry is available free, even in government setup nowadays. So this is the radiopaque markers. Again, what you do is that will be a capsule with the 25 markers inside. You take one x-ray at that particular day, and after 5 days, you take another x-ray. Retention of more than 5 markers out of 25, more than 5, if it's retained after 5 days, the patient has no transit constipation. So this is a picture actually. So this is normal transit, okay? The markers are seen almost uniformly from top to bottom, whole colon is filled up. So here, that's a defecatory disorder where the transit time is normal. The transit time is normal. So everything gets accumulated in the rectum. And defecogram again, more theoretical. So this picture just shows normal resting phase, the squeezing phase, straining phase, and after erection. This is a normal phenomenon. The same thing picture without using dye again, with an MRI you can get a similar picture. So this balloon expulsion test, again, you insert a balloon filled with 50 ml of water and ask the patient to strain. Just find out how many seconds or minutes the patient takes to pass. So this is a normal position actually. This is a Western toilet. This is the ideal position, they say. This is not the ideal position, they said. And normally what people say is your thighs should be flexed much more. So Indian toilet, they said, it's more useful to pass. So anorectal manometry, again a big topic by itself. Now we come to the subject proper. So you have non-pharmacological therapy as well as pharmacological therapy. What is more important is reassurance, lifestyle changes, more fiber and fluid. Always remember, any constipation, fluid and fiber, more than you give trial for 1 month, most of the patients will recover. And dietary fiber, it's very effective in relieving mild to moderate constipation. Around 20 to 25 grams per day is more important. 20 to 25 grams per day of fiber. Whole wheat bread, unrefined cereals, and fruits, what we take like raisins, prunes, and some people say even our the so-called kadaka, our Indian this one. It's branded, it's available. The Picoricea purva, the kataka, it's available as capsules. The other common fibers available are methylcellulose, 4 to 6 grams per day. This is very frequently available. The market more than 30-40 years actually. Isabgula has obtained from the psyllium seeds. Again, it's available widely throughout. Then you have the polycarbophyll, calcium polycarbophyll. You have guar gum from gum caria. What is widely used is Isabgula has. Then you have the osmotic laxatives, again, magnesium. During our UG days itself, we were thought that in antacid, magnesium will cause diarrhea, will cause constipation. So magnesium in various forms like magnesium hydroxide, magnesium citrate, magnesium sulfate. The snack itself is very cheap actually, available as Epsom salt. Normally we use it for bowel preparation before colonoscopy. And the sodium, then we have plain sodium sulfate, that's a Gleyber salt, etc. And phosphate, again, it's available as enema as well as oral forms, but we have to be in using this in renal patients, we have to be very careful actually. Then we have poorly absorbed sugars like disaccharides. Very, very common use is lactose, it's in the market for more than 50 years. The combination of galactose and fructose actually, it's taken the dose of 50 to 30 ml once or twice per day. It's actually supposed to low, actually it passes unmetabolized through the colon, there it's split by the intestinal bacteria. It lowers the pH, it has a laxative effect, and particularly hepatic encephalopathy, it decreases the ammonia producing organism and lactic acid producing bacteria will increase. Then other thing like sorbitol, unabsorbed sugar, which is used as a solvent in many syrups, etc. can be used. Mannitol again 15 to 30 ml. Those days we are using it frequently, nowadays we don't use it. Now what is widely used, irrespective of it, right, in children as well as adults, we use it so-called the big polyethylene glycol. Again, it's not absorbed in the intestinal tracts actually. So it has an osmotic effect. It's available in various forms like a powder form. Depending upon the molecular weight, it comes in 400 molecular weight, etc. Nowadays for bowel preparation, we use it widely. And even in older patients with constipation, it's available. So we have some stimulant laxatives also, which increases the motility. It has a fast action. The more commonly used in those days were anthraquinone derivatives like the Senna derivatives as well as Cascara. Then castor oil was used initially, resinous combination, castor oil, almanac. Then what was widely used and still people are using now is diphenyl methane derivative, DPM, diphenyl methane derivatives, talcolex, so called as pisacodyl, 5-10 milligram. And again, another derivative of that is sodium picosulfate, Kermalex, that's also widely used now. So just put it in a tablet column. So main thing will be a fibers, bulk supplement, psyllium seeds, calcium polysulfate, carbosyl and methyl cellulose. They retain water in stool, increase stool bulk as well, but thereby it improves the consistency. Adverse effects are mainly bloating actually. We have to explore obstruction first, that's more important. Stool softeners like docoset sodium, so called the dioctyl sodium succinate. This was widely used in gynecology in those days. Actually, that is used even as a wax solvent actually, docoset. It promotes luminal water binding, but that's a surfactant like effect, it doesn't like action. It rarely can cause a cramping. Then we have stimulant laxatives in the form of Senna, widely available like Senna sites. It's a glycoside derivative. Disaccordant sodium sulfate. These drugs increase the industrial peristalsis by acting through the myenteric nerve plexus and it decreases the large intestinal water absorption. Osmotic laxatives, I said earlier, big lactulose, solid, sorbitol, milk of magnesia, etc. Now we have a few newer drugs also, like the lubiprostol, which acts through the chloride channels. It's available in the market as lubiprostol, but not that widely used. Linaclotide is not available in our place right now. It's a guanylate cyclase activator. It acts through the CFT level. So now this is very frequently available, so-called the prucaloprid. Almost every company has brought this drug now actually. It's a 5-hydroxytryptophan receptor activator. So what happened was initially, actually something like sisoprid only. Sisoprid was there initially, it was a very good drug for constipation, but because of the cardiac, it's not cardiac friendly. Some people developed arrhythmia, some people developed cardiac failure, and 2010 it was totally banned. So after that, now the prucaloprid is very cardiac friendly, it's widely used nowadays. Available 1 and 2 milligram tablets, 1 milligram for elderly patients and 2 milligram for adults in the night it's given. What is more important now, we have this biofeedback therapy also. But this part is taken care of psychiatrist.
So thank you very much.
Myself is banned also.
It's not banned, but it's available. Very cheap actually. For sigmoidoscopy and all, we still use it, madam. Even government setup will use it.
Pediatric patients which are
No, polyethylene glycol is used very frequently. Available as Peglec powder as well as now it's along with this Ispagol powder also it's available. With this Ispagol also it's available.
So what is
gargum? Gargum was available, nowadays we don't use it. Gum carrier, it's obtained from plant derivative only, gum carrier. Gargum. I'm not sure. Some people say it's useful for stomach pain actually, but basically it has a laxative. It's mentioned in our textbooks also.
We have one more topic. I invite Dr. Srinivas to ask a certificate of appreciation.